I never imagined that I'll be in Iceland.
My name is Mazen Maarouf. I was raised in Beirut as a Palestinian refugee. I've lived all my life in Beirut and part of my childhood in the camp of Shatila. Lately, I was obliged to leave Beirut for political reasons, and I live now in Iceland.
Já, þetta var bútur úr heimildamynd sem Al Jazeera gerði Mazen Maarouf, ljóðskáld, palestínumann frá Líbanon, sem að hefur verið búsettur á Íslandi núna í tvö ár. Mazen, I have a couple of your poetry volumes here.
Yes.
I think this is the way to... I don't know how to turn them.
Yes, the other way.
Yes.
This.
Yes, way. And then I read them backwards.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
From right to left.
From right to left, yes. You have been staying in Iceland now for this time, but originally you are a political refugee, really.
Yes, I'm actually mainly political refugee here, and I'm here actually because of my writings, of my political writings. Like, poetry may not have this big effect on regimes, but in the direct way, but due to some political writings that I did, so I was obliged to leave the country in Lebanon. That's also, I was a Palestinian refugee there. And after some threats, I had to leave, mm-hmm. and I came to Iceland.
Yes, of course the situation is very chaotic there with the war in Syria and everything.
Yes, actually, yes, it is. And,
it's always the Palestinians who start suffering because they don't have a state.
Yes, definitely. And there, you know, I was born as refugee, and after like living for more than 30 years in Lebanon, I don't have papers there. I'm not allowed to be given any kind of papers, you know. So I'm not totally Palestinian in a way. I cannot refer to the Palestinian authorities in Gaza or West Bank, and I'm not Lebanese at the same time. So I'm in this very gray area, and when I open my mouth and criticize a regime like the Syrian regime for killing people, then definitely I will be in trouble because I'm the least protected person there. And also, I also, like, I had troubles, let's say, not only with the Syrian regime, but with any side that kill people or like these Islamists now claiming that they take part of the revolution, but they are doing they hijacking revolutions in Egypt, in Syria, yes. and everywhere. I have also problems with these people. Like,
but you are a poet, and you have published three volumes of poems. Tell me about your poetry, your writing.
Yeah. I'm interested in politics at the time, but when it comes to poetry, I cannot write a political poem in the direct sense, let's say. So my poetry is based maybe on the consequences of the huge political system in the world. So I try to talk about the individual himself, outside any political Palestinian context, because I believe that this is another thing and we can write other things when it comes to politics. But I believe that what we live in life, the details of everyday life, are consequences of political progresses going on every day.
And you go around with your little notebook there. Can you show us the notebook?
Yes.
And of course you write in Arabic, with Arabic letters.
Yes, I actually, this is my notebook that
yes.
I take notes or sometimes try to write poems wherever I go. Let's say.
And you have...
And this is the luggage, let's say, the luggage of my mind.
Yes.
In a way.
And you have been writing poetry here in Iceland. How?
Yes.
How is it for you to be living in this country?
It's a big experience. Actually, the way I look at Iceland and how Icelanders treat nature, women's rights issues, the political system, I feel that Iceland is very different reference to the world when it comes like you want to describe the whole world and the capitalism or whatever you want to talk about. And then when you come to the Icelandic way of of treating nature of or of solving their political problems as well. It's very different and very special. And for me, I learn a lot from such experience in Iceland. I learn from the Icelanders because I came mainly from a place that's under tension all the time. So when I arrived to Iceland, that's no political tension in the same way I want.
Well, we don't have weapons. We don't we don't carry weapons. We don't have an army.
When I arrived,
it's a big difference.
Yes, I called my mom actually, and I told her, "Mom, there is no army here. You know, this was for me big deal to be in a place with no army, to be in a place like Iceland, but also because my mechanism, like my mental mechanism, works or used to work under this political tension all the time, because it's part of my life, but without thinking of. So when I came to Iceland and I realized that there is no this tension in the way that I used to, it was somehow confusing in a beautiful way.
Tell me, are you published in Icelandic? Are your poems published in Icelandic?
Yes, some poems got published in Stina magazine.
Yes.
The last issue, I think. And there is a collection of poems will be published. It's going to be published maybe at the end of this year.
But you're also translating Icelandic literature into Arabic.
Yes.
For example, Sjón's book.
Yes, I translated Sjón's novel Skugga Baldur, Blue Fox, into Arabic, and it's now released, and it's big success.
Okay.
It has, like, it was, they are talking about it in the newspapers, and it was on the TV as well last time there in Beirut.
And you also have a volume of Icelandic modern poets in
Yes, I actually, yes, I translated 10 poets so far from Iceland into Arabic, and I published them in newspapers between Beirut, London, and Abu Dhabi. So I'm trying also to spread the Icelandic poetry to the people who mainly got no chance, Arabs got no chance to read Icelandic poetry, and I'm very happy to do this, and there are ongoing projects, actually.
We are going to end this by showing a poem from this Al Jazeera documentary, a poem you wrote. What is this poem?
It's called DNA.
DNA?
Yes.
It's
very... Yes, I think I wrote it in 2001. Like, this is written like 12 years ago. And it sounds a little bit political, but it reflects my situation in Lebanon as political refugee. Like, who is wanting to get out of this, because we are locked there. I don't have any civil rights there. I don't have any kind of human rights in a way. So it was kind of a scream, this poem.
Thank you, Masin. It's a pleasure having you here in this show and in this in our country.
Thanks to you.
Thank you.
Thanks. DNA. ثمة طريقة واحدة للصراخ أن تتذكر أنك فلسطيني. طريقة واحدة لتأمل وجهك غير المرتب في نافذة الباص، حيث تمر أيضا بعض الأشجار التي تقف أمامها وبعض العتالين. طريقة واحدة لبلوغ طبقة الأوزون خفيفا كبالون بالهيليوم، للبكاء لأنك وغد حقيقي. طريقة واحدة لتضع يدك بين نهدي التي تحب وتحلم أشياء بعيدة، اللوفر وشقة صغيرة في إحدى ضواحي باريس. والكثير الكثير من الوحدة والكتب. طريقة واحدة للصراخ في البلاليع، حيث صورتك تتراءى ثانية في مياه المجارير، حيث تتذكر حينها بطريقة واحدة فقط أنك لست حتما إلا فلسطيني.